Good morning, church. We are thrilled that you decided to worship with us. If you would do us a favor, that would be greatly appreciated. Take a picture of who you are worshiping with and post it to the hashtag C3Together at YouTube or Instagram, and we'll love to see your smiling faces. We are here to worship our God and to lift him up in praise. I've been thinking recently about why do we do that. One of the reasons is he deserves it. He is worthy of our praise. But we have served such a great God, I'm reminded of the verse in Romans where it says, but God shall cause all things to work together for good to those who love him, to those called according to his purpose. I've always thought of that verse as God can string together or work together all the bad things that happen to us for our good. But it not only includes the bad things, it includes the good things. He commands us to praise, not only because he's worth it, but it's for our good. And he is in control to let us know that he is sovereign and in control. So we're going to start off with a song that reminds us of that. Sing along with us.
Stars and you call them by name. The skies proclaim, God, you reign. Your glory shines. You teach the sun when to bring a new day. Creation sings, reign. Sing this. God, you reign. God, you reign. Forever and ever. God, you reign. You part the sea. God, you reign. more time. God, you reign. God, you reign. Forever and ever. God, you reign.
Well, good morning, church. It is so good to be with you. And we're excited to say that we are moving towards getting to the place where we can get back together. We sent out our surveys. Thank you all, those of you that filled it out and you sent it back. And here is our tentative plan as of right now. We are looking towards a May 31st time where we will open our doors. Now, again, a lot of that, we don't know what's going to happen, but that is the goal. There's many churches that are opening this week, some next week, but we're gonna wait to the 31st, and we're going to do everything we can to keep people as safe as possible. I can pretty much guarantee this. It will definitely be safer than Kroger's, and most likely safer than Costco. So we're doing what we can, and we're excited about that, and it's going to be kind of a soft opening. We're not going to have all our programs going. And again, we are going to be announcing and getting information out to you in the days and really weeks to come. So if you are not part of our email distribution list, please contact the office because you need to know what's going to be happening. And we would encourage you to do that. We are happy to announce the Wozniaks. Yesterday, Jennifer had her baby, and Lucille Jennifer Wozniak was born at 12:24 yesterday, 8 pounds, 12 ounces, 19.75 inches, and we rejoice with them, and we thank the Lord for his goodness. And so I want to pray right now, just for us, and then we're going to have a time of prayer together. But I just want to pray for you right now. Lord, I thank you that you're the God of the universe. I just thank you for your love and your care, and that you reign. Lord, we sang it. It's true. You reign. And Lord, we thank you for the Wozniaks and just Lucille's birth, and we give you thanks for that delivery, and that mom and baby are well, so we commit them to you. Lord, may you be honored, in Jesus' name, amen. Now, on the screen, there are a few, though not all, of the attributes of God, and as we go to a time of a prayer in your home, let me encourage you to look at God's goodness and mercy and love and his justice and his grace and his power and his sovereignty. And just as a family, pray and give thanks together.
Father, I want to thank you for your mercy. You are so many things, but your mercy has meant a significant amount to me here recently. I am not what I tend to think of myself. But your mercy covers a multitude of sin. And your mercy keeps me going, and I pray that and I know that your mercy will allow me to become more and more like your Son. Thank you so much for your mercy. I also want to thank you for your goodness. You give and give and give and give We know all good gifts come from you. And we want to acknowledge that, not just at dinner time. But I pray that we would take time out to thank you and recognize your goodness in sustaining us and giving us purpose. You are a good, good God. I want to lift this up and pray this in the name of your Son, Jesus. Amen.
And I've heard a thousand stories of what they think you're like, but I've heard the tender whisper of love in the dead of night, and you tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. And I've seen many searching for answers far and wide, but I know we're all searching for answers. Only you provide, 'cause you know just what we need before we can say a word. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You're perfect in all of your ways to us. Sing that again. You are perfect in all of your ways. You're perfect in all of your ways. You're perfect in all of your ways to us. Oh, it's love so undeniable, I can hardly speak. It's peace so unexplainable, I can hardly think. And you call me deeper still, and you call me deeper still, and you call me deeper still into love, love, love. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am, it's who I am, it's who I am. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are, it's who you are, it's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am, it's who I am, it's who I am. Father to the fatherless, defender of the weak, freedom for the prisoner, we sing. This is God in his holy place. This is God clothed in love and strength. Sing out, lift your voice and cry out. Awesome is our strong God. Mighty is our God. You're with us in the wilderness, faithful to breath and every step we sing. This is God in his holy place. This is God both in love and strength. Sing out, lift your voice and shout out. Awesome is our strong God, mighty is our God. Sing out, raise your hands and shout out. Awesome is our strong God, mighty is our God. There is none higher, no. None greater, no. There is none stronger than our God. There is none higher, no. There is none greater, no. There is none stronger than our God. And cry out, awesome is our strong God, mighty is our God. Sing out, raise your hands and shout out, awesome is our strong God, mighty is our God. Higher, no. There is none greater, no. There is none stronger than our God. There is none higher, no. There is none greater, no. There is none stronger than our God.
This morning, I'll be reading from the book of Isaiah, the 6th chapter, verses 1 through 5. And I would ask that the people of God, wherever located, stand for the reading of God's word. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting upon a throne, high and lifted up, and the train of his robe filled the temple. Above him stood the seraphim. Each had six wings. With two he covered his face, and with two he covered his feet, and with two he flew. And one called to another and said, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory." And the foundations of the threshold shook at the voice of him who called, and the house was filled with smoke. And I said, "Woe is me, for I am lost, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips, for my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts." This is the word of God, sharper than any two-edged sword.
Thank you, Dale. Let's pray together. Father, we come to you, and I would pray that you would speak to every one of our hearts, that we would see you as holy, holy, holy. Lord, we give this time to you. Do your work in our lives. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Today's passage is one that I've been looking forward to for quite a while. It is 1 Peter chapter 1, starting in verse 15. It says, "But as he who has called you is holy, you also be holy in all your conduct, since it is written, 'You shall be holy, for I am holy.'" Let me just read that one more time. "But as he who called you is holy, you also be holy in all your conduct, since it is written, 'You shall be holy, for I am holy.'" I have a message to deliver today that is difficult to deliver and it is difficult to hear, but it is desperately needed. It's difficult to deliver because we're talking about things that we can't fully comprehend. And it's hard to hear for the same reason. We don't understand fully God's holiness. And there is a limitation to words in this. And so I'm going to do my best. There have been books written about this that I'm going to encourage you to read at the end. But there's nothing like this in all of our experience that we can understand the holiness of God. We get, like when during the prayer time we had you look at God's love and his mercy and his justice, we can get those things. We understand those things. But none of us get a full understanding of the holiness of God. I read an article this week where someone had visited a concentration camp where hundreds and thousands of Jewish people died, and they said that they felt like they were on holy ground, and there was a reverence and there was an awe of being there. And they walked around in silence. But even that doesn't even grasp what holy ground that we're going to be going into. Some of it was just how people could be so wicked to each other. And we are all in need of understanding this. And here's the crazy thing about God's holiness. You don't get to say what God is like. God has clearly revealed who he is in the scriptures. We don't get to pick and choose in this. And so my prayer for us as we have come to this message, my prayer for you has been that we would see God as holy, that we would stand in reverence and awe before who he is. As a people, we would be passionate for God's holiness. And in light of that we would be concerned and passionate about how we live and our holiness. And so we're going to break this into 2 weeks. This week, we're going to deal with the holiness of God, as he who has called you is holy. And so we're going to look at God's holiness. And then next week, we're going to look at the whole concept of be holy. We're called to be holy as he is holy. And so we're going to look at that next week. Over the last couple weeks, I have gone back and reread two of the books that have transformed my life in this issue. One was The Pursuit of Holiness by Jerry Bridges. I read as a young believer, totally changed how he looked at things. And then R.C. Sproul's The Holiness of God, both of those books I am recommending that you read, and I'm going to talk about that in a little bit. And I've listened to several messages, and so I'm going to distill all of my thoughts into what I think you need to hear and that what I have needed to hear. Before we even get to a definition of the holiness of God, I want us to start by looking at why an understanding of God's holiness as his fundamental attribute is essential. Why is an understanding of God's holiness as his fundamental attribute essential? And it really is. And for some of you, this is going to be new territory. Every generation since the creation of mankind has struggled to understand and to grasp God's holiness. Every generation has. But in every generation, as people get it, as they come to get a glimpse of God's holiness, it changes everything. It begins to change everything. In 1 Corinthians chapter 10 and verse 31, it says, "So whether you eat or drink or whatever you do, do all to the glory of God." It has been said that the glory of God is the manifestation of his holiness. And I know in my own life, when I started to get a glimpse of what God's holiness was, it changed everything. It changed how I lived. It changed my motivations. It changed how I interacted with people. It changed how quick I repented. It changed how I treated others, how I communicated. And again, not perfect in process, but I want us to raise our sense of this holy God that we serve, not as an external show, not as an outward appearance. I want this to be an understanding of God's holiness that transforms our lives when nobody's around. We've all been in churches where people have faked holiness. But I want this to be so moving that you know that God is infinitely holy no matter where you are. And so that passage that Dale just read, we're going to go through it quickly. It is the record of the call of Isaiah, perhaps one of the most dramatic records of the call of any prophet. It was in the year that King Uzziah died, and King Uzziah was an important and good king over Judah. And it says, "In the year King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting on a throne, high and lifted up, and the train of his robe filled the temple." Now, just try to imagine that for a second. We've had many weddings here, and brides will come down in beautiful gowns, and they'll have a train to their gown, but it won't fill the room. God in his robe, it filled the temple. And it says, above him stood the seraphim. By the way, that's the only place that seraphim are mentioned in all of Scripture. It says, each had six wings. With two, they covered his face. With two, they covered his feet, symbol of reverence and awe. And with two, he flew. And one called to another and said, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory." The whole earth full of his glory. And the foundations of the threshold shook at the voice of him who called, and the house was filled with smoke. Again, awesome presence. The power of God is there. And what is Isaiah's response? "Oh, that's cool. I feel blessed. Isn't this great?" No, he says, "Woe is me, for I am lost. I am a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips. For my eyes have seen the King, the Lord Almighty, the Lord of hosts." Isaiah was transformed. In an instant, when he got a glimpse of God's holiness, everything changed. He saw his own sin. He saw his own brokenness. He saw that he was lost, that he was undone, that he was unclean. And so was everyone else around him. I just got to ask you, have you ever come to a place in your life where You have seen God for who he is, and you said, woe is me. Woe is me, I'm undone. I know, even for me, it was after my salvation, and I was reading Jerry Bridges' book, The Pursuit of Holiness, because I'd been struggling with sin issues, and I got a glimpse for the first time of this holy, holy, holy God. And I was like, woe, woe is me. And it, that phrase is repeated. The description of God's holiness is repeated in the New Testament in Revelation 4:8, where God is called holy, holy, holy is the Lord Almighty. Now, the question, why is the threefold repetition? Why holy, holy, holy? It's called the trihagion. And often in the Old Testament, when there was a phrase that was going to be emphasized, they would use it three times. You'll see the temple of the Lord, the temple of the Lord, the temple of the Lord. And so this repetition is the expression that it is an important thing. It is quite common, but when it comes to God's holiness, this is something that is truly unique. And there is a passion and a force that is wanting us to see, the Lord wants us to see his holiness as supreme and essential to his characteristic of who he is and his awesome deeds and his awesome nature. R.C. Sproul rightly points out in his book, The Holiness of God, only once in sacred scripture is the attribute of God elevated to a third degree. Only once is the characteristic of God mentioned three times in succession. The Bible says that God is holy, holy, holy. Not that just he is holy or that he is holy, holy, but that he is holy, holy, holy. Never in the Bible does it say that God is love, 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 or mercy, 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 or wrath, 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 or justice, or justice, justice. It says that God is holy, 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 and the whole earth is full of his glory. So, holiness is God's primary, fundamental, governing, moral attribute. And we need to see this. Theologically, it can be argued that not all of God's acts are acts of love, but all of God's acts are acts of holiness. Let me repeat that. Not all God's acts are acts of love, but all of God's acts are acts of holiness. And I've been praying about this. Brothers and sisters, we got to get this, because it will change how you view God. But what if we don't? What if we make love the primary, fundamental, governing, moral attribute of God? What if we say that God is love, love, love? And it sounds great. I mean, I'm not against love, especially God's love, trust me. But what if all creation would be designed to satisfy God's love? If that were the case, then we would never, never talk about sin. Because that's kind of not loving. And we surely would not talk about judgment. And we would absolutely never talk about hell. Why? Because that's not very loving. And sadly, there are many who look at the attributes of God and they say that his governing, fundamental, moral attribute is love. And so they never talk about sin. They never talk about judgment. They never talk about hell. And in reality, though they do not physically rip massive portions out of the Bible, but in a real way, that is what is happening. And my fear is that is what happens in some of our lives. And it is not accurate, and it is not faithful to not only God's word, but it is not faithful to God and who he is. Paul Tripp, in an article I read this week, great article, he said this: first and foremost, the doctrine of the holiness of God sits at the center of the grand narrative of the gospel of Christ. Without the holiness of God, there would be no moral law to which every human being is responsible. Without the holiness of God, there would be no divine anger for sin. without the holiness of God, there would be no perfect Son sent as an acceptable sacrifice for sin. Without the holiness of God, there would have been no vindication of the resurrection. Without the holiness of God, there would be no final defeat of Satan. Without the holiness of God, there would be no hope of a new heaven and a new earth where holiness will reign over us and in us forever. And he goes on to say, yes, it is true that the biblical story would not be the biblical story if it were not written and controlled at every point by one who is holy, holy, holy at all times and in every way. Oh, we got to get this. And when we do, we see things the right way. A.H. Strong has said this, and it's a great quote. Holiness is the track on which the engine of love must run. Again, we're going to see God's holiness, and we're going to see God's love. And God's love is amazing, and it's even more amazing in light of his holiness. So, God's love is a holy love. God's truth is a holy truth. Even anger. When I get angry, it's not good, nor is it holy. In Numbers chapter 11, the Israelites, after God had delivered them, and they're complaining and grumbling all the time, and they wanted more, they wanted this, and Numbers 11:33 says, while the meat was yet between their teeth, before it was consumed, the anger of the Lord was kindled against the people, and the Lord struck down the people with a very great plague. God's anger was a holy anger. Same thing with his justice. God's justice is a holy justice. We read in Exodus 34:14, for you shall worship no other God, for the Lord whose name is jealous, is a jealous God. And his jealousy is a perfectly holy jealousy. And so, it's so important to see that God's governing fundamental attribute is his holiness. And it's essential to get that. Now let's look at the definition. You'll see why this all fits together. A definition of God's holiness. Holiness defined. God is holy. He is untouched and unstained by the evil in the world, absolutely pure and perfect. That's why this is so hard to explain. I cannot bring something to you. I can't bring an illustration that says, here is something that is absolutely pure and perfect. Back in the day, they used to have ivory soap, and they would have commercials that it is 99.44% pure. But it wasn't 100% pure. In our translation, when we look at the Hebrew word for holiness, it means to cut. To be holy means to be cut off or to be separate from everything else. It means that it is in a class of its own, distinct from anything that has ever existed or ever will exist. God is perfectly holy. He is absolutely pure. That's why it says in Habakkuk 1:13, your eyes are too pure to look on evil. You cannot tolerate wrong. Revelation 1 or 15, verse 4, who will not fear, O Lord, and glorify your name? For you alone are holy. He alone is holy. And second thing, God stands apart and is totally unique. He is in essence, he has his otherness. He is totally unique. Exodus 15:11 says, who among the gods is like you? O Lord, who is like you? Majestic in holiness, awesome in glory, working wonders. And the answer is, no one's like the Lord. God is entirely pure and totally apart. And that is why A.W. Tozer has said this, and it's such a great quote. We cannot grasp the true meaning of the divine holiness by thinking of something or someone or something very pure, and then raising the concept to the highest degree we are capable of. God's holiness is not simply the best we know, infinitely better. We know nothing like the divine holiness. Can I just say that again? We know nothing like the divine holiness. And yet, so often we kind of like, God's holiness. But God's love. Oh, we love his love. But holiness, we don't want to talk about his holiness. And we need to. We must. Psalm 99, verse 9 says, extol the Lord our God and worship on his holy mountain, for the Lord our God is holy. Now, to drive this home, to the best of my ability, I want us to look at God's holiness demonstrated. I mean, we see different parts in the scripture where Moses, when he was at the burning bush and he came towards the burning bush, and the Lord called out to him and said, do not come near, take off your sandals, for the place that you are standing is holy ground. And we get a little glimpse of that, but I want to see some more things. In Leviticus chapter 10, in verse 1, it says, now Nadab and Abihu, the sons of Aaron, each took his censer and put fire in it and laid incense on it and offered unauthorized fire before the Lord, which he had not commanded them. And fire came out from before the Lord and consumed them, and they died before the Lord. So here are these two priests. They're offering incense, and they offer a strange fire, an unauthorized fire, thinking, hey, what's the big deal? You know, we're just going to do our own thing. And they violated what they had been told to do. They said, we're going to do our own thing. And God in his holiness, because he's holy, he dealt with them in a holy and just way. And so the next verse, Leviticus 10:3, says, then Moses said to Aaron, who had just seen his two sons killed, this is what the Lord has said, among those who are near me, I will be sanctified. I will be holy. And before all the people, I will be magnified. And Aaron held his peace. Aaron didn't say a word. This happened because Nadab and Abihu, they knew nothing of the divine holiness. Let me give you another illustration. In Israel, the ark had been taken by the Philistines and then given back. And years later, David's going to bring the ark back to Jerusalem. And it says in 2 Samuel chapter 6, verse 3, they carried the ark of God on a new cart and brought it from the house of Abinadab, which was on the hill. And Uzzah and Ahiah, the sons of Abinadab, were driving the cart. And then it says in verse 6, it says that, or verse 5, and David and all the house of Israel were celebrating before the Lord with songs and lyres and harps and tambourines and castanets and cymbals. They were worshiping. So here they are. They're bringing the Ark of God back to Jerusalem. This is great. We're having a little worship service as they go forward. Everything's good, right? Well, verse 6 says, and when they came to the threshing floor of Nacon, Uzzah put out his hand to the ark and took hold of it, for the ox stumbled. So here they are. It's on the cart. They're going along. The ox stumbles. The ark is going to fall off. Uzzah reaches out and he touches it. He grabs it so it doesn't tip over. He's a hero, right? Isn't this great that he saved the ark from falling to the ground? The next verse. And the anger of the Lord was kindled against Uzzah, and God struck him down there because of his error, and he died beside the ark of God. And you read that kind of like how David responded. David was like, David was angry. He's like, what happened here? What just happened here? Why did he die? I don't get it. And what happened was they had been given a prescribed way that they were to carry the ark, that the Kohathites were to to move the ark on poles. And it says in Numbers 14, verse 15, you're not to touch the ark. And if you do, you will die. He had given him what he had said. This holy, holy God said, listen, this is the way you got to do it. It's interesting. I remember the first Raiders of the Lost Ark movie. There's that scene where the Nazis open up the ark and they look in and fire comes out of it and it burns everyone around. And it's like in that movie, they understood that you're not supposed to do that. And if you do, you're going to be judged. And I will just say this. We look at that and we say, wow, that's so harsh. And the reason like we would say that is because we know nothing of the divine holiness. You can't play around with it. And so often in this culture that we live in, we do. And some will say, you know, God was grumpy in the Old Testament, and then he got happy in Jesus, and in the New Testament, it's all good. But let me tell you, God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. It says in Malachi 3:6, I, the Lord, do not change. God is as holy today as he was back then with that ark when he took Uzzah out. He was as holy as when Nadab and Abihu died for offering strange fire. And so we have to understand. When we come into the New Testament, we see an example in Ananias and Sapphira. And let me just set this up. Ananias and Sapphira, they sold a piece of property. And let's say they sold it for 100 grand. And they're talking among themselves as husband and wife. And they say, well, let's give 75,000 to the Lord and say that was the whole price of land. We'll keep back 25,000 for ourselves. And in Acts chapter 5 and verse 3, but Peter said to Ananias, why has Satan filled your heart to lie to the Holy Spirit and to keep back part of the proceeds of the land while it remained unsold? Did it not remain your own? And after it was sold, was it not at your disposal? Why is it that you have contrived this deed into your heart? You have not lied to men, but to God. And then verse 5 says, and when Ananias heard these words, he fell down and breathed his last, and a great fear came upon all who heard of it. And the same thing happened to his wife a few verses later. God, concerned for the holiness of his fledgling church, wanted his people to be holy. And so, God is still holy. Now, let's look at the results. Seeing God's holiness, what's going to happen? The results of that. What will that look like for us? Because I know, here's what I know what I'm getting. A lot of you have been raised, God is love, love, love. And he is. Don't get me wrong. But he is holy, holy, holy. And when we see his holiness, we do become like Isaiah, who say, woe is me. I'm undone. I have no holiness apart from Christ. I'm ruined. And by the way, I live amongst the people of unclean lips. Everyone battles with this. We don't see God's holiness. We don't see him for who he is. We are ruined. And without him, we would be lost. We would be damned. We would be of no hope. We would have no hope. Because God's eyes are too pure to look on evil. He cannot tolerate wrong. I'm in trouble, and so are you. But here's the good news of the gospel. John chapter 3, verse 16 says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. That's the glory of the gospel. And here's where we see how God's holiness and his love come together. God in his love sent his Son, Jesus Christ, the Holy One of Israel, who was the spotless Lamb of God, who comes to take away the sins of the whole world. And by the way, he's the only one that could save us. That is why when Jesus said, I'm the way, the truth, and life, no one comes to the Father except through me. That's not an arrogant statement. He is the only holy one. He's the only one that could pay the price for our sins. And we have many. I have many. And so 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 21 says, God made him, Jesus, who had no sin. He was holy. To be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God. We get Christ's imputed righteousness. It is given to us when we, by faith, turn and trust him as our Lord and Savior. He bore our sin on the cross. And that's where, when you see God's holiness and him going and taking my sin, let alone your sin, on the cross for us, what amazing love that is. And the word says in Romans 10 and verse 13, for everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. When you understand what he has done and you turn in faith and you say, Lord, forgive me, and you give him your life, he will forgive you of your sin as you turn and you repent and you give everything to him. Because of Jesus, because of his great love, now we can come boldly to the throne of grace. Now we can call him Abba Father. But there is a danger. There is a danger in disrespecting and taking God for granted. It is something that I've observed, and I think it's been in every generation, to be quite honest, that we take God's holiness lightly. He is a awesome, holy, pure God who is to be feared in reverence and awe. He's like a dad. I describe this to people. He is like a dad who is a loving father, but who is also loves his children enough to discipline them. Which, by the way, the Bible says in Hebrews 12, whom the Lord loves, or 6 or 12, one of those two, whom the Lord loves, he disciplines. And that's how he treats us. So he's a loving God where he calls us into his arms, but he also, we can't forget that, who among the gods is like you, O Lord? Who is like you? Majestic in holiness, awesome in glory, working wonders. And so, what has he called us to? But as he who is called you is holy. But as he who has called you is holy, you also be holy in all your conduct. Since it is written, you shall be holy as I am holy. I hope and pray you can understand this. And don't run away from this. You can't. If you start to run away from this, you will find yourself figuratively or in a real way ripping Scripture out. And you can't do that. If you're struggling with this, if you have never had a glimpse of God's holiness, I encourage you to read those two books. R.C. Sproul's The Holiness of God and The Pursuit of Holiness by Jerry Bridges. They are life changers. But when we get this as God's people, we will want to glorify him by living lives that are right and pure and honoring to him. Just as he who has called us is holy, we want to be holy. It changes the price tags. It changes the motivations where we want to, because we understand what he has done for us. I'm going to pray for us, and then we're going to sing a great song that talks about God's incredible holiness. Let's pray. Father, I come before you, and Lord, forgive me for my inadequate words of trying to describe your greatness and the splendor of your holiness. Lord, you alone are holy. And we stand before you and we are humbled. We thank you that love does run on the tracks of your holiness, and you so love the world that you gave your only Son that we who are sinners might be accepted before an infinitely holy God. So Lord, we give you thanks and we give you praise. May we not ignore, may we not make light that you are a God who is holy, holy, holy. Lord, as we sing, May you speak to our hearts. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Sing this with us.
That you understand this. If you have questions about this, please don't hesitate to reach out to myself or to Pastor Jason. The God we serve is an infinitely great and holy God. He is holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. Let me just conclude. After he said he is holy, holy, in Revelation 4:11, he says, "Worthy are you, O Lord and God, to receive glory and honor and power. For you created all things, and by your will they exist and were created." And he did it for his glory. All God's people said, amen. Have a blessed and great week.